This week at the Net Cafe, the Global Net. This is the internet version of Where in the World is Carmen Sandiego? Only here you get to follow a real person on the web. Celia Francis will show you how to get your website instantly translated into a foreign language. If you can't find a .com URL for your new website, what about .to? Welcome to Tonga. Bill Hannafin is Irish, but he lives in the States. To keep in touch with what's going on in Ireland, he created the Irish Abroad website. APC.org is a site which is helping countries around the world use the internet to further democracy. The Global Net, this week at the Net Cafe.
The Net Cafe is made possible in part by CyberSmith, wired for fun and learning, with locations in Cambridge, Massachusetts, Palo Alto, California, and White Plains, New York. By TechWeb, for up-to-the-minute technology news. And by TVA, Television Associates, bridging the worlds of computers and video with DVD authoring and MPEG encoding services.
Hi, and welcome to the Net Cafe. You know, one of the really cool things about the internet is its global nature. It really is this international village that we all read about 10 or 20 years ago. You can be in a chat room or in a game room. Next thing you know, you're talking to some guy from Europe or Latin America or Asia. One of the really cool aspects of this is if you're from a particular community or a particular nationality, even though you're far away from home somewhere else around the world, you can still be part of that community. We found a great example, a site called irishabroad.com. And Andrew is with the founder of Irish Abroad. His name is Bill Hannafin.
Bill, you've created a site, Irish Abroad, and we're talking about the global net tonight. I think it's pretty interesting. I think the Irish people, among many great things, are known for being a very social group, a group that likes interaction and things like that. To me, the net sometimes doesn't feel like it maybe would have enough interaction, or maybe it does. What, you know, why did you create this site?
Well, I think the Irish are also very well known for traveling. Mm-hmm. I mean,
that's for
there's
sure.
Predicted that there's 70 million people who can claim Irish heritage around the world.
Wow, it's a big group.
So it's quite a large group. And the web, more than ever, is becoming a medium for finding out where things are on and mm-hmm. what's happening. And we've tried to focus a lot on that, on particular areas of our site. So Irish are also very well known for the pubs. And we've got a huge section in there on find your local in your area
right,
and entertainment,
right.
all that sort of thing.
From a communication aspect, do you find that people are getting online via your site and connecting with what people they want to meet, or people for information for jobs, or using it, like you said, to go to the pubs?
Absolutely. It's a young site, but it's growing at a phenomenal rate. It's being used more and more every month. The hits are going way up.
How many people do you think are coming to your site on a monthly basis?
About 150,000 a month.
Wow,
yeah,
that's a good group.
We've had some good exposure lately. We've got a couple of awards on Yahoo and a couple of Irish search engines at home that
who
have definitely got our name out there, and that's helped us a lot.
Right.
And since then, people have been using the news boards and communicating, you know, putting messages on there and getting a lot of feedback on the different areas.
Who would you think is your sort of average or your typical Irish user that's using your site today?
The way we've got the site broken up, we actually have a number of different users.
Mm-hmm. You've got three areas, I think, that I
exactly,
saw.
Exactly, yeah. We've got an area called Setting Out, which is basically for anybody in Ireland thinking of leaving, thinking of emigrating.
Okay.
And that basically deals with accommodation, mm-hmm. employment. There's a message board on there, mm-hmm. studies, if you're looking at studying abroad. And it's got just general information on heading out, visa information,
right,
immigration.
Right, useful information on
exactly,
the immigration
yeah.
site.
The green card lottery, there's
right.
a whole application form on
right.
how to do that.
Okay, so that appeals to people who are in the country and maybe are ready to come to the United States or go somewhere else abroad.
Exactly, yeah.
Okay, what about when you're already here or you're in one of these other countries now and you're looking to stay connected or find information in your community?
That's where our Living Abroad section, it's we've categorized it into different areas where
mm-hmm.
we're trying to get the communities that are the biggest all
mm-hmm.
around the world,
mm-hmm.
and for example, Boston, New York, San Francisco, Sydney, you know, and there's certain areas
right.
around the world where there's larger pockets
right.
of Irish communities, and we've started with those, and on those sections we've got like a full, that's where we have the pub listings,
mm-hmm.
there's an event section where basically anybody can add their event, so all the pubs can go in and right online they can say what's on in their pub on Tuesday night. You know,
and I saw also, I think it was job listings as well, people looking to hook up for jobs, and that
there's a whole database where people can put in jobs that are coming up and search for jobs.
And now the third section I see is once you're here and now you're maybe thinking about going back, or is it a trip back or to stay permanently?
It's a bit of everything. There's a resource there for moving back, jobs at home, real estate, that sort of thing. There's a genealogy section for anybody trying to find their roots at home, you know. There's a tourist section for people who are just thinking of visiting Ireland, you know. And it's got images of Ireland and got information on different guides on where to go and what to do. And there's also a full event section for Ireland, so you can see what's on in County Kerry in August.
Right.
You know?
Okay, this is great. So it's not just for the Irish expat or other people. It sounds like it's also for anybody looking maybe for a trip to Ireland. So I'm gonna check it out before my next
trip. That's one thing that's very important that we want to put across about this site. It's not solely for Irish-born people. It's basically for anybody who has an interest in Ireland. And it tries to cover every aspect.
For URLs of today's featured websites, just go to the NetCafe site at cnptv.com.
The trouble with this global web business is we don't all speak the same language. So what happens if you go to a website and it's in French or German or Russian? And I guess the answer is you go to Alta Vista. You guys have this online live translator. And I was able, for example, to translate our homepage and our website from English to French just by clicking a button that quickly.
Yep.
Is it that easy to do this in all these languages or any website?
Yeah, it's very easy. We offer English into five languages and back again.
Okay, what are the five languages you go to?
Spanish,
right.
French, Portuguese, German, and Italian.
Okay. Now, what language translation engine are you using? Because it was very quick.
It's the Systran translation engine.
All right. Now, I go there. What can I do with this? Say I go to a website. It will translate any page in a website for me just by clicking that button.
That's right. Actually, in fact, in the near future, you're going to be able to put a little Babelfish icon on your browser. And then at any page that you're at,
so
where you can't
read it. Anytime I get to a foreign language page, I click
foreign language page of those five languages, you'd click, specify which language you want to have
That's
it translated into. And the whole page, you can read it then.
Now, we tend to be very English-centric on the web and think everybody speaks English in a way, but is there a lot of demand for this translation stuff?
Yep, we have about 450,000 translations a day.
Half a million almost a day of people doing this.
Yep.
All right, what are the different ways I could use it? Let's say, number one, I do a search, a typical situation, and I see some of the top hits are in another language. They're in French, Italian, Spanish, and I want to read it in English. What do I do with your search engine?
Well, first of all, if you want to use the translation service, you can just go to that page and then immediately translate it.
Click the button and say, show it to me in English.
That's right.
Okay.
That's right. You can do that. Now, of course, if you, for example, are someone who speaks only French and you don't want to see English pages, or maybe you speak only Estonian or Arabic, Alta Vista actually offers you the possibility of limiting your search to 25 different languages.
Okay, so I can search in the one language I understand.
That's right.
All right, let's turn it around now. Let's say I want to send an email to somebody and I've found something interesting, but it is in Portuguese and I don't speak Portuguese. I can actually write my little email in English and say, hey, send it to this guy in Portuguese.
That's right. That's right. Very easy.
Now, how good is the translation? That's the only thing that makes me nervous, because my French isn't perfect, but I did an English-French thing, and it was a little bit clunky there. It's not real good French, but is it good enough to get the point across?
Well, I'd say a warning to your viewers.
Okay.
If you're a student, for example, and you think this is an easy way to get your homework done, don't cheat.
It's not that good.
Well, if you're a first-year student, it's going to be much better than you are. It's
okay.
Too good. So your teacher will notice right away that your vocabulary seems to have improved overnight.
Yeah.
However, if you're a second- or a third-year student, you'll probably get in trouble because your grammar might not be perfect in every case, and some of the words might not be perfectly translated.
Don't use it to do that homework or
something. In fact, our number one request seems to be, can you do Latin?
Now, what about from a business point of view? Again, I mean, you wouldn't want to translate a contract or something and sign anything based on this translation, right? It's just sort of a guide to
It really just gives you a rough idea of what the page is about. I speak French and German, and I use it, and it does a pretty good job.
Satisfied. What do you do with the languages that have different character alphabets? I mean, the Chinese and the Russian and the Arabic and the Hebrew. Can you deal with those languages?
Well, we don't offer those languages yet for translation. However, those are all the languages you listed are languages that are indexed, which is the largest index in the world according to the Guinness Book of World Records. Because of that, mm-hmm. we actually have more pages in those languages than any other search engine, and we recognize them and can limit your search to those pages and set up your browser
so it can read
those characters.
All right, it's very impressive. It's Alta Vista. Thank you very much.
For URLs of today's featured websites, just go to the NetCafe site at cnptv.com.
You all probably remember that great educational game, Where in the World is Carmen Sandiego? Well, the original Carmen predated the World Wide Web, but now in the internet era, there's a new kind of real-world version of Carmen in which you track a worldwide traveler by figuring out what he is doing on the web. Well, Jane is with the creator of this new online global adventure and the lucky guy who's doing the traveling.
So, Mike, Andy, I heard a rumor that there's no such thing as the World Wide Web, that it's really just the United States. Is that true?
Well, here's living proof that it exists in about 8 other countries.
At least 8 other countries, and it is completely worldwide. I went back, went around the world,
checked in. What exactly did you do? I mean, you told me you were a foreign exchange student?
I was an exchange student. I went to 6 universities, the greatest universities in the world, and I had a digital camera, I had a laptop, and I sent back clues, and you had to find where I was, and if you found out where I was, you want a trip around the world on United.
So this is basically, it's called Xscape.
Xscape
was the website, and you can find it through Excite.
Xscape.excite.com.
So this is like what you're calling global online entertainment. I mean, I could learn things about the places that you're going to. I have to guess the clues that you're giving
me. You cannot win this game without using the search engine. There's a real educational component to it, which is a lot of fun. It's not just take a hit and throw a dart and try to guess. This is really the sentences in the clues are crafted in such a way that you have to use a search engine.
So I have to be on the web. I have to do my homework to be able to do that.
And then Andy added the realism to it, in that there's a real person out there. This wasn't just a stick figure, some animated figure. This is a real person flying red-eye flights from the Middle East into Europe and all around the world. And so there was a real adventure to it. And so, much like our previous television shows, we wanted the audience, the online viewer, to vicariously share this adventure, get a little escape from their everyday life, and really feel that they had experienced something through Andy's eyes.
So basically you had like a digital camera?
I had a digital camera, I had a laptop, and I also had a digital video camera. I would try to log on. Most of the world is wired, although you'd be surprised, in the San Francisco Bay Area, we're so much more used to, I'll email you, I'll do this, or whatever. But the rest of the world is not quite there, although a lot more so than you'd imagine. So I would get online, and I would go to the local ISP provider. I had the little Sony Mavica. It's not a plug for Sony, but folks, this thing is great. But if you want to send me a camera, it's okay. And you pull the floppy out, slide it into your computer, attach and go.
Now, so this was going on. You were 13 days on the road, traveling across the globe.
All the way around the world.
People were guessing every day where you were and so on and so forth. Who ended up winning?
Well, a gentleman from St. John, New Brunswick in Canada.
A Canadian
won it, and he said he played every night, and he would use the clues and then look at Andy's dispatches and try to figure out where the university was.
Do his homework, maxed out on points. So what's next? So you've covered the, you know, exchange student concept. What's the next step?
Well, obvious. Christmas. We're going to do Escape Xmas, but escape the shopping madness and all the commercialism of Christmas, and go on an adventure around the world to find the roots of all the Christmas celebrations we take for granted and never knew where they came from.
So how many days are you going to give this time?
This will be about 20 days on the road, and we're going to go back and find where gift giving came from in the Middle East. We'll be finding out what Yuletide means in Scandinavia, where the first Christmas tree came from, where Christmas caroling came
from. So you're already giving us some clues to do our homework before you guys go live.
A little bit. I mean, it's intuitive. It's using the web and search engines, but it's being intuitive as well.
So this whole idea of being global is you're starting to really manifest this in this entertainment type, education type forum.
We're perfectly living proof of that. I went around the world. I was online in real time, and people were following me around the world.
My daughters would get up and run downstairs and
where
is he? And then when your picture came up with Mao Zedong in front of the Forbidden City, I mean, they went,
wow. Great.
and they knew that that had happened while they were asleep.
It was really cool stuff. I'm looking forward to checking out the Christmas experience at escape.com.
For URLs of today's featured websites, just go to the NetCafe site at cnptv.com.
Countries outside the United States identify their websites with a unique high-level domain name, for example, .uk for England or .tw for Taiwan. Well, some small countries have discovered there's a pretty good business in licensing these domain names. The classic example is the tiny country of Tonga. Its domain name is .to. Now, Andrew is with a guy who's running a very interesting website called tonic.to.
Eric Lyon, you're from a site called Tonic, and most people are used to hearing tonic.com, but I know yours is a little different. It's tonic.to.
That's right.
And we're talking about the global web, and I know your company is involved with a country I think most companies didn't know had anything to do with the web, Tonga. How did you guys get affiliated with a country like that?
Well, it dates back to my partner's early trip to Tonga almost 6 years ago now, where he struck up a very strong friendship with the Prince of Tonga, His Royal Highness Crown Prince Tupatoa, his father's king.
And this is a small island.
Yeah, about 110,000 people.
In the South Pacific.
South Pacific, 300 miles from Fiji.
Okay.
And they are the owners of the .to top-level domain.
Okay, now let's explain top-level domain for the average person.
Well, let's see, there's about 240 of them, actually. Most people only know about .com.
Right.
But there is one for every country on the planet.
Okay.
And Tonga's is .to.
Okay.
Most countries administer them internally, only allow citizens of the country to use them. But about a year and a half ago, we liberalized the .to domain and made it accessible to the world.
Okay, so basically it's almost like an area code for each of the countries on the web.
Right,
okay,
exactly.
So now comes Tonic, and you guys have come up with a little bit of a business model for the company and for the country of Tonga. How does that work?
Well, we register names just like the internet does in .com. You can come to our website at www.tonic.to using a credit card for $100, 2 years registration. You own that name. No one else can use it, and it is a globally unique name.
Okay, what's the advantage of having my site name be .to at the end?
Well, aside from the cachet of a small piece of virtual island real estate, the real value is there, it's a much less crowded space than .com. .com has over 2 million names registered in it. And so many common, ordinary names that you might think would suit you and available off the shelf are long gone.
Right. I actually saw recently companies like GoTo.com, for instance. That's a pretty common thing.
Right.
Very expensive to buy that from somebody.
That's right. That's right. So there's a vastly larger inventory. It's also much simpler to administer. We were the first to create a registry that is completely driven from a website. You can register the name and do everything from the website directly.
Okay. How much does something like this cost the average person?
Well, it's $100 for the first 2 years registration, and then $50 a year after that.
Okay, and do I have to then host my website on the island of Tonga? It sounds like it might be a little difficult.
No, you can do it anywhere. You know, virtually any ISP can host the names. They work just like .com names. They're globally accessible. So you just have your current ISP or maybe one of millions of hosting companies actually host the name, provide email or website, whatever.
Okay, and now I understand you guys are actually in business with the Prince of Tonga. So some of the revenue from this company is going to the Tongan government and the prince. What are some of the things that the island is going to be doing with this revenue, and how are they sort of adopting the internet as a whole?
Well, about a year and a half ago, January of 97, we set up the first internet connection in Tonga, set up an ISP there. They have one dish that connects the island for all communications, telephone and now internet. And we set up a very small ISP, and they have over 200 customers now. And they estimate there's only about 600 computers on the island, so it's a pretty good
penetration. So you've already got one-third of the internet users or potential
users
right away.
But also we set up a distance learning center. My partner and the Tonga High School there set up this advanced learning center for the brightest kids coming out of Tonga High.
Very important when you're in an island in the middle of nowhere. I think the next closest island is like New Zealand or something.
Yeah, Fiji's 300 miles and still very remote.
Right.
So this, you know, for the first time puts them directly in touch, gives them access to everything available on the internet, and in particular some distance learning programs. In fact, working with Stanford's brand new distance learning program where they provide college education and post-high school education, trade education. So
it's a benefit for both users and people on the island. Well, great. We'll check it out.
For URLs of today's featured websites, just go to the NetCafe site at cnptv.com.
It's obvious that the web, the internet, have had a tremendous effect on activism, on populist causes, even on traditional politics. The internet is an incredible tool, obviously, for communicating, for soliciting support, for exchanging information. It's no surprise, then, that lots of global organizations are using the internet in an attempt to establish democratic institutions around the world. Jane has the story of one very interesting organization like that. It's called the Association for Progressive Communications.
So, Mike, you know, I think one of the things that I certainly take for granted living in Silicon Valley and, you know, surrounded in the world of the internet is that I have access to a phone line, that I have a browser that I can use, and I've got lots of, you know, available time and resources to get the information that I need.
Right.
Now, you're representing countries and people who are involved in social activities and social actions across the globe. But what's it like outside of, you know, sort of mainstream web world?
Right. Well, I think people who try and use internet technology in Asia or Africa or South America will have very different experiences depending on where they go. If you go to someplace like Johannesburg, it's almost like being right in the United States. You can use the web, it's maybe a little bit slower. But say you go just 100 miles out to the tiny town of Umtuntwini in South Africa, and you just try and get email, you might have a really hard time because the phone lines are just are not so good, so it's difficult to use the internet.
So the quality is so poor that I can't even get a consistent connection, is what you're saying.
That's right.
So, I mean, you know, when we think about the internet, we think it's this great place where people can come together and they communicate and they can share. And you're representing a lot of people who are underrepresented to start with, and now you're trying to use technology. So how are you doing that, and how are you overcoming some of those communication issues?
Well, I think the main thing is to build on existing organizations. You know, say that there's, you know, there's a women's program in Uganda that focuses on sustainable development among women helping each other. This internet program is not all by itself. It's tied into using existing networks of women who know how to teach each other how to do things.
This is people networks. People who know people and they talk to each other.
That's right. Yeah. So, you know, like right now, those women in Uganda aren't all at home surfing away, you know, checking up all these different things. But how it might be is that they, you know, they're really going together and they're saying, we've got to develop a new type of knitting project. And we want to do some research on how they've done similar projects in Peru or Madagascar, or try and look for funding in the UK or in the United States. They want to be able to have fast research and people-to-people networking around the world.
So how would they do that?
Well, a group like the APC has been working for years to help different groups get online and leverage the existing technology that they have. So there might be like a library in a mid-sized town in Nigeria, which has, for 2 hours, they have a phone line connection to a university research institution, which then is connected to the internet. So what the APC would do is we might have, you know, some trainers based out of South Africa who train all over Africa, who go in and they work, and they're experienced working with these women's groups and showing them how to use the technology which is there to do the research.
All right, so they basically teach them, they give some coaching, and knowing that they've got a really narrow window, they've probably got a lineup of people who want to get access to this one tool that's available and find a quick way to do that. What are some other examples of using the internet and trying to connect people across the globe in this kind of situation?
Well, you'll often find that activists in particular have similar needs all around the world, and that they're much stronger when they can talk to each other and share information and ideas. One example is labor organizing. You've got companies which, you know, go from country to country to country, and they try and, you know, crush unions or exploit populations in different countries.
And they've got lots of money and lots of power. They can handle the PR engines.
Right. And they get experience, so when they fight workers in one country, they learn how to do it in another country. So if the workers can also take the experience of how they fought the company in one country and apply that somewhere else, then they have a fighting chance to sort of being on an even playing field with the companies.
So then being able to use the internet and being able to communicate with people across the globe, they're able to share their experiences and learn more quickly how to solve these problems.
That's right.
Thanks so much, Mike.
For URLs of today's featured websites, just go to the NetCafe site at cnptv.com.
And we're here as usual with our resident net expert, Larry Magid, syndicated columnist with the LA Times. Larry, we're talking about the global internet on this program, and it's not really global, is it? I mean, it's dominated by the English language. It's still dominated by the United States, dominated by California, for that matter, isn't it?
Yeah, in terms of the numbers, I mean, the vast majority of users are in the United States. Now, of course, there are websites generating from overseas, and there are users there, but
the numbers are
right here in the United States.
Now, what's the problem? I mean, I know in Europe, for example, I mean, the whole telecom problem is complicated and costly, isn't it?
Right. You know, when you make a local call in most European countries in the U.K., you pay per the minute, and that'll add up. You can't
scan the internet. So that net access is pretty darn expensive.
Absolutely.
And you may not have a local place to go, so it's even a poll call after that.
So there's a cost issue. And then there's a cultural issue. I mean, the fact is that a lot of European countries, perhaps rightfully so, are a little worried about the invasion from America.
They don't like the fact that there is no geography, borders anymore.
They've all got ministers of culture. Even the Canadians have a minister of culture. And they've got language police. And
you can invade with information,
very easily. And so there's a big cultural reason. I think that until there's a lot of local programming coming from Europe, and other countries, of course, it's going to prohibit the real expansion.
And I guess you have hardware issues in third world countries and infrastructure issues also.
Absolutely.
So got a way to go before it's really a worldwide web.
Worldwide, you're right.
All right, Larry, thanks a lot. That's it for this issue of Net Cafe. Hope you'll visit us here next time.
The Net Cafe is made possible in part by CyberSmith, wired for fun and learning, with locations in Cambridge, Massachusetts, Palo Alto, California, and White Plains, New York. By TechWeb, for up-to-the-minute technology news. And by TVA, Television Associates, bridging the worlds of computers and video with DVD authoring and MPEG encoding services. To purchase a videotape copy of today's program, call toll-free 1-888-310-7850. Please specify the show number and the topic.